kids. It's time to get some SML podcast all up in that.
I've never had anything outside of regular Mountain Dew, and it's only okay. I'm not really a Mountain Dew guy.
The funny thing is, like, my area does not have this in cans. I actually bought this when I was visiting friends in Illinois, but my Walmart does have a generic one, so I have the generic and the real.
Oh, see that? Wow, for some reason, the real one can look so much better. Don't know why. It just looks like they
amazing.
Actually
sound. Go figure.
They look like they actually put some effort into designing it.
Oh, man, I guess we should start this shit.
Yeah, if you want to get to your game before it's over.
Yeah, probably. So, what's up, everyone? This is the SML Podcast, episode 221. I am your host, Joe. Joining me this episode is CJ Greenwood. CJ, welcome back.
Hi.
Why do you keep doing this?
I don't know. It's just something to do on the weekends. I'm pretty bored.
Like, That's a lot of boredom.
Yeah, and it also takes away from the podcast that I get to listen to.
I know. But hey, the bright side is there's going to be an interview for the second half of the episode.
Well, I mean, if there wasn't, I wouldn't do the show. I need something to listen to.
Makes sense. Yeah, second half of the episode, I will be talking with Will Dubé of Thunder Lotus Games, talking about their brand new release, Jotun, or Jotun as it's properly pronounced, but they prefer to say Jotun because if you said Jotun, no one would know what to look up for online, and they would probably spell it without a J.
Or spell it like I spelled jar.
WanderjahR.
Yeah, I didn't expect that. I thought it was going to be about a jar.
It is.
Oh, shit, it is.
Totally about a jar. But before the interview rolls around, we got some shit to take care of. Got some shit to take care of. And you know what? I'm even going to throw you a bone, and I'm going to toss out some news.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, we're not just going to jump into reviews, because there is some horrible, horrible news that came out last week. And that is South Park, the Fractured Butthole, was delayed to next year.
I was actually going to bring that up if you asked me if I had any news.
Quarter one, 2017. So we don't know when next year. Maybe like March-ish, I would guess. But fuck.
It works because there's a lot of games coming out that people want this year. And that's just another one. If they wait a little bit longer, I don't think... If they wait enough, there won't be enough other games out to really drown that one out.
Yeah.
So it might work.
As long as it's not in February, because so far, February next year is ridiculously loaded.
It is. For Honor, Halo Wars 2. And
Sniper Elite, Persona 5, Horizon Zero Dawn.
Oh, jeez. I didn't even know that Sniper Elite was coming out.
Yeah, February 14th, same day as For Honor.
I wonder which one's going to sell more.
I'm going to guess For Honor.
Yeah, me too.
And then Persona 5 is the same day as well. So they got to stop releasing so much shit at the same time.
I don't even know what that game is.
Persona? RPG.
I've heard of Persona before, but I've never actually played them.
RPG. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Not an RPG guy. So, like, I've never liked Final Fantasy.
Really?
Yeah, I played Final Fantasy VIII on the PlayStation 2. For a couple of hours, and it was really boring and dragging on. I just traded it in.
Final Fantasy VIII was a PlayStation 1 game.
Was it?
Yeah.
Which one? It was like, I swear it was like Final Fantasy VIII or 9. Did they re-release 8 or something?
10 was on the PS2.
I don't know.
Technically, like you could play PS1 games in a PS2, but...
No, I know it was a PS2 case for sure. And also, GameStop wouldn't allow me to trade it in because the next generation was already out, so PS1 was eliminated by that point at GameStop. I guess it was Final Fantasy X. I don't fucking know.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of X, so maybe that's the one you played.
I don't fucking know, man. That was like 7 years ago. I was like a child. I didn't know.
No. I'm excited for 15 though. And maybe the delay of 15 contributed to South Park getting delayed, because in like an 8-day span from November 29th through December 6th, there's Final Fantasy 15, Mario Maker 3DS, Gravity Rush 2, Steep, Dead Rising 4, and The Last Guardian.
Well, The Last Guardian also, didn't that receive a delay?
Yeah, to December 6th.
Oh, okay. I thought they actually delayed it like full on till 2017.
Nope, December 6th.
Well, the only game out of that I really want is Dead Rising 4.
Yeah.
I'm such a Dead Rising fan.
I can't wait for Dead Rising 4. It looks so good.
If I had the money, I would have bought the pack, because I love those games.
No, you should get it.
Yeah, I don't have money.
You should get it. Well, the thing is, if you do have money before getting that, you should donate to the SML Podcast PlayStation VR GoFundMe, available right now at GoFundMe.com/PSVR4, the number 4, SML. Help us get a PlayStation VR so that we can cover it on this show.
Nice plug.
Hey, I gotta.
You do.
And stay tuned for, I don't know if it's the next episode, maybe the one after that, because I know Chris wanted to be around on episode 222. So I don't want to make the Loot Interactive show 222.
Well, but, it's not around for that.
The Loot guys rip on me hardcore for having the GoFundMe up. And, you know, like, the day after I have a Recore unboxing.
that is funny.
Yeah, you will definitely have to stay tuned for that Loot Interactive show, because it's, oh my god, that had to be one of the funniest ones we've done with them.
Like, I love Loot Interactive.
I couldn't breathe by the time that show was over. I was laughing so hard. I was like,
sounds like a good one.
It's nearly 3 hours long, and nothing got accomplished. It's not like this episode where there's part news, part interview, or like couple reviews, and then it's just 3 hours of nothing.
Well, sometimes that's the best something you can give.
Very true. So, do you have any other news you would like to discuss besides the whole South Park delay?
I wish. I don't think I do. No, I don't.
I can't wait till you get a new microphone.
Is it doing it again?
Oh, yeah. It's been. I told you, it's like the ocean, where it just every now and then it's
Yeah, I wish.
It's the tide coming in.
Did you talk about the 3 new backwards compatible games?
I was going to save that for Chris, but I guess we'll mention it now.
All right.
So, yeah, 3 new games added to the Xbox One backward compatibility lineup. You were eager to talk about this, so how about you tell us what they were?
All right, I'll go in alphabetical order, since I'm like that. First is Bound by Flame, which is something that I've
action
never
RPG from the folks at Spiders and Focus Home Interactive.
Oh, fuck, I love Spiders.
Yeah.
The company, not the actual thing. And then The Maw, which I missed somehow when it was, you know, forever they were giving it at like McDonald's or something. And I never got a code for that game.
You dumb bitch.
And then Virtua Fighter 5 Final Showdown, which is the arcade game, not the actual Virtua Fighter 5.
Yeah, so it's still another fighting game. Good to have more fighting games. And that actually puts the total of backward-compatible titles, or technically forward-compatible titles, titles that work with the backward compatibility program.
You really don't like the actual term.
It's just people use it wrong. If backward compatible means it's compatible with the previous generation, like, that would mean that Dead Rising 4 worked on a 360, but it doesn't. Yeah,
the truth is that the console is backwards compatible because it works with the games from the previous. Games are not actually backwards compatible.
Yes, exactly. Pet peeves. That's how it is. But
if they were going to make a fighting game, they should just make Mortal Kombat 9.
They've been talking that Mortal Kombat and Injustice are supposed to come to the program. Just who knows when? You know, we're still fucking waiting on Skate 3. So
yeah.
And we're waiting.
I would have had to hear about that another week if you talked about it on that show.
Waiting on the BioShock games, though, with the trilogy getting re-released. Who knows if they're actually going to happen or not?
I don't think so anymore. I think that's a thing that you shouldn't count on. With that happening, I highly doubt it.
I think if it's going to happen, it's going to be in like another month.
The only way I see it happening is if they surprise us with a games with gold for at least one of them. That's the only way that they're going to do that now.
Maybe. I'm thinking after the sales die down for the remaster, they'll be like, all right, now we'll add it to backward compatibility.
Yeah, wait until everybody's already spent their money.
Yeah, then, pretty much.
Although, wasn't BioShock Infinite already a game with gold like a couple years ago?
Yeah, it was before the whole backward compatibility program. So.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Like, they didn't introduce that until, like, last year.
And Sion is in the chat, so how you doing, girl? She says, what's up, bitches, to us?
Well, I'm not a female dog.
No, but you're still a bitch.
Well, okay.
Yeah, bitch.
I mean, I guess I am if I'm willing to accept that.
If you're doing this show, you are a dumb bitch.
I guess so. That's what I deserve.
Yeah, you really do. You really do.
It's my fault.
She's asking what we were doing podcasting on a Sunday, and we are recording some reviews and a little bit of news to tack on to an interview that will be at the end of this show. So that is what we are doing podcasting on a Sunday.
While the
fucking Steelers are playing. So I'm not paying attention to that right now.
I know it's hard for you, Joe.
I know it's very hard. It is
taken out of context. That would be funny.
It is so hard right now.
I request you cut this.
That's all staying in. You don't mind that I listen in, do you? If we didn't want people to listen in, we wouldn't be streaming. So yes, please enjoy. Please treat it like any other show where
we haven't even started
chit chatting. Well, we said a little bit of news.
We did.
I mean, I did an intro, so it's just, you know, it's all there.
Yeah, it is.
But anyway, we got some reviews to take care of, so we might as well dive into those. The first game that we will chat about this week is called Perfect Woman, developed by Peter Lu and Lea, I'm going to destroy this, Schönfelder, I think.
Yeah, I could see how you could destroy that.
Lea Schönfelder, I think.
Looks right.
Apologies if I got it wrong. It's big words confuse me. Released September 14th on Xbox One for Kinect. This is a Kinect title for $8.99. Perfect Woman is a game inspired by the ubiquitous personality questionnaires featured in women's magazines and the female roles they define. There are so many roles emphasizing aspects of family, career, experience, sex, and more, but these cannot possibly characterize the depth and complexity of a woman's life. Perfect Woman uses these stereotypes as building blocks for you to be your own perfect woman.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we had a review written in by our friend Frodo, and we will get to his review now. He says, will this woman get a perfect score? Let's see. He actually says 10 out of 10, but we don't do numbers on this show.
I think he's just rating the woman, not the game.
Maybe. He says, Perfect Woman is a Kinect game which asks you to make life choices as your character reaches milestone ages. Similarly to reality, the choices you make at younger ages can have an impact on those options, which are more easily available to you as you age. Each stage has a difficulty level, which is indicated on the menu screen in order for you to make an informed choice. Each difficulty level appears to have its own selection of moves, which are easy to learn and follow as they are fairly repetitive. This repetitiveness can make the game a little tedious if you constantly select the same difficulty level through your life, though it can make it easy to progress through the game quickly. Perfect Woman seems to mirror the player perfectly as the game is responsive to movements and allows some leeway when matching the character's shapes. The character's shapes appear at a basic level on the screen as the graphics are simplistic, however they do their job well enough. Similarly, the sounds behind the gameplay are also basic and mainly unnoticeable, with the exception of the call girl level, where the sound effects become very noticeable. Perfect Woman has an M4 mature rating and is, therefore, able to include a number of adult topics. Unfortunately, some of the content is not handled very sensitively, as there are references to a child dying of leukemia and demented individuals, which, along with a number of mentions of terrorists, can make for an uncomfortable gaming experience. Whilst the game highlights some important issues which are deserving of discussion, this is perhaps not the appropriate place or method to do so.
All right. And I mean, it sounds like he doesn't like South Park either. And that also references all that stuff.
A fairly short review for him. He wasn't really a fan of the game. He suggests avoiding the game. But I completely disagree with him. First off, I will fully acknowledge this is going to be an incredibly divisive game. People are going to look at the visuals of the game, which all look like, I don't know, hand-drawn by children, kind
yes.
of?
Yes, it does.
And I feel that the humor is incredibly tongue-in-cheek. Like, there is no way that a game featuring, like, a 60-year-old call girl with a blue vagina hanging out is trying to take itself seriously.
Oh, I didn't even see that. I'm glad I didn't, because I don't want to see that.
Or, like, an 84-year-old, God, what the hell was it? Like, a tribal woman, topless with old saggy titties hanging down, and when the level ends, she erupts into flames and like her rib cage is hanging. Like, there is no way that this game is meant to be taken seriously at face value. It's an incredibly tongue-in-cheek game. It is, quite honestly, it's fucking insane. I mean, it is
funny.
It is absolutely ridiculous. The gameplay, as mentioned, is basically, there's a silhouette on the screen and you have to match the silhouette with your body positioning. I have always had trouble with some Kinect games due to my large frame and my small living room, so sometimes the camera doesn't read me as necessary. I did put some time into it this morning. I actually had Frodo handle the review because I've been having back problems lately, but I wanted to get some time into the game myself, so I played for quite a bit this morning, and it's ridiculous. It is just so fucking weird.
It sounds hilarious.
I don't know how else to put it. It's just, it's fucking weird.
I think I know how to put it. That sounds amazing.
God damn, don't make me pull that clip back out.
God, don't do it, please. That was fucking absurd.
I should just make that like my new text sound or something.
Don't do that.
Sounds amazing.
You'll always know when I'm texting you. You should just set it as like the Twitter notification when you get a DM.
Oh god. Then for some reason my phone doesn't make noises when I get DMs or messages anymore, and I don't know why. It's irritating.
Did you accidentally turn it off?
I don't think so. It's just Twitter has always been bitchy on my phone, so I don't know.
Oh, that sucks. Did you give it a try it, buy it, or deny it rating yet?
I didn't give it anything yet. Again, like Frodo, it was not a fan of it, but I enjoyed it. I think, again, it's going to be an incredibly divisive game, but if you have a fucked up sense of humor and you are looking to put the Kinect to some use, it's a hearty try it. It's not for everyone. It is really, really, really not for everyone.
But I mean, going back to South Park getting delayed, here you go.
Yeah. It's definitely not for kids. This is not a game for kids. Like, it wears its M rating proudly during some of the, like, the fucking call girl stages.
I can't believe the game even got released on Xbox, but it sounds like funny. Like, and a Kinect game for adults is a really weird like audience to direct something
at. It's like it kind of like an exercise style game because you're doing like yoga style poses, and it's an M-rated yoga style. It's so weird. It is such a weird concept. And I
have one question. Is there stripper scenes, and in it do you actually have to do like stripper moves?
No, all the gameplay stages are basically, they give you the silhouette that you have to match, and it rotates between like four different ones.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So it does one, and then you get graded, and then it changes, and you got to change to the other one, and then it grades you, and then it changes to the third one, and then to the fourth one, and then it basically loops over and over. If you miss a bunch in a row, you can die in that stage, which, just for shits and giggles, on like one of the very first ones, you're like a princess posing on a pier, and I just failed out of it, and a fucking killer whale bit my head off.
Oh my god, I didn't expect a killer whale.
It's so fucking funny. It's just, like, the gameplay is not very complex, but it's enough to keep you going through it to see the different scenes and the different events that happen in the game. And it's just, it's weird. I do enjoy the fact that, depending on what paths you take and what, choices you make, it will change the difficulty for the future choices. If it's on easy, then you have plenty of time to do the pose. Normal, a shorter time. Hard, a shorter time. And if it's on extreme difficulty, it's basically instantly changing. So you're going to fuck up. So it's
some kind of perfect woman to do that.
Yeah. It's not like the poses are more complex as you go through the game. It's just the timing window is much smaller as you go to higher difficulties.
Oh, all right.
Yeah.
I think it'd be unfair if the box was a little bit smaller for bigger people.
Yeah. I mean, it's not like a one-to-one representation of you on the screen. Basically, it's just tracking your movements, and it's kind of like you're puppeteering the character on the screen.
Well, I mean, according to Frodo, it does a good job of tracking you.
So yeah, it did nice a fairly well so job. Again, with mine, I've always had issues because I'm a fat dude, and my baggy clothing likes to throw off the Kinect. So, but yeah, overall, I enjoyed the game. I thought it was fun. Some people out there are calling this like the worst thing to ever be created. And
it's worse.
It's goofy. It's hilarious. And if you're taking it seriously, I don't know, go outside, take a breath, fresh air.
That's chill. A good suggestion.
So for an overall rating, I'm giving it a try it. But if you're a Kinect owner with a fucked up sense of humor, it's $9. Grab it. So, Sion,
also, why do you own a Kinect?
Because I bought it day one.
I mean, I bought it too, but that thing's been unplugged since I think a month after I got it. I was like, screw this thing. It keeps doing things that I don't want it to do, so I'm just going to unplug it.
Having it mute, pause, play, like, that's
I can do all that with my controller.
Record that it's... I will never get rid of my Kinect. I love it.
I hate it.
That's a conversation for a different episode.
Just the entire episode, just like arguing about Kinect.
Listen, motherfucker.
I've never had an interest in Kinect games. The only thing that I did like is that in Rise, you could like call out the things, and that was way faster than holding the button.
I love my Kinect. I use it daily. I will never get rid of it. But yeah,
each their own.
Next game to chat about is called Claire Extended Cut, developed and published by Hailstorm Games, released September 6th on Xbox One for $14.99, previously released August 30th on the PS4 and the Vita. While visiting her sick mother, Claire takes a wrong turn and stumbles into a dark passage of echoing doors and abandoned rooms. Lost in attempting to find her way back, Claire encounters an overprotective dog and few denizens who are seemingly uninterested in Claire's plight. Did they block the doors and windows to keep something out, or is a malevolent force stopping Claire from leaving? Why does the sun seemingly never rise, and why are there red candles scattered across the grounds? As panic sets in, time slips and begins to fall away. I'll get this out of the way. This game is fucked up.
Yeah.
Not in the goofy, crazy way, in like the disturbing, creepy way.
The screenshots make me know that I'm never going to play this because I don't like horror
games. It is all pixel style graphics. It is a 2D survival horror style game where you are exploring a dilapidated hotel, or not hotel, hospital. Words are fun. You're going through corridors, exploring rooms, heading to dead ends. You are trying to get out of there and find your mom and not die. And it is this game is creepy as hell. Like, the first time I played this, I was like, you know what? I'm going to do this right. I'm going to play it at night. I'm going to turn the lights out. Eternal Rage is in the chat, so hello. You're probably right in time for this game since you like the scary shit.
I think that was a mistake to turn off the lights in a horror game.
Oh, my God. It was the dumbest thing I've ever done, turning off the lights and playing it at night. Like, I had nightmares that night. I had legit nightmares from playing this game.
I've had other games like that that's just like, I can't do that. I would be the first to admit Five Nights at Freddy's, I couldn't sleep for three nights after seeing that. And I didn't even play it. I was just watching it.
Yeah, this game, it just like fucked with the right parts of my brain. No, we are not talking about Emily Wants to Play. We are talking about Claire Extended Cut from Hailstorm Games, which, like I said, 2D pixel graphics, survival horror. There is not much direction. Like, there'll be times where it's like, you need to go here and it's a locked door and you're like, how the fuck do I get it? And you have to basically explore the hospital, find where you need to go, solve puzzles that can be fairly difficult. Like, they don't spoon feed you the information that you need. You have to figure it out.
I'm with, God, how do you say the name?
Which one?
Well, obviously not Eternal.
Surly?
Yes. Yeah, I'm with Ixnay on the scary games.
Yeah, Chris is the same way, but, this game it's a fucking trip, man. It's so good, but I wish there was a little bit more, hand-holding for some of the parts, because I got stuck for quite a while, and I wandered the entire hospital back to front trying to figure it out. And it was just a puzzle where I knew that there was a puzzle to it and I couldn't figure out what it was. So I was just like, oh, well, maybe this is just for like a little bonus thing. But no, it was, you had to flip portraits based on, I guess a common thing among them. I don't want to ruin the puzzle, but you had to, solve it, and that's how I was able to progress through. And it's just, oh man, when there's like little tiny monsters that'll be hanging out in the hallways that you could like try to jump over or avoid, or just change direction and leave the hallway. But then there's this big motherfucker who shows up at different points where if you find him and he gets you, it's game over. It's kind of like the Nemesis in Resident Evil.
Is that the chainsaw dude or no?
No, this was in Resident Evil Nemesis.
I didn't know that was a game.
Yeah, Resident Evil 3 Nemesis.
Oh.
The Nemesis in Nemesis.
Okay, well, you can't blame me for not knowing. I've never been a fan of Resident Evil. I played 4 and I hated it.
I guess it's comparable to the chainsaw dude too, except you can kill the chainsaw guys. Like, this giant monster, all you can do is hide.
Outlast style.
Yeah. So, man, it is so good. It is. this is another one that is definitely not going to be for everyone. Like, you don't touch this with a 12-foot pole.
I wouldn't even touch it with a 15-foot pole.
Chris, he's not going to want to touch it. Sion in the chat, she's not going to want to touch it. Eternal, you're going to want to drop the $15 on this game because you're going to fucking love it.
Yeah. She liked Emily Wants to Play.
Yeah.
It's all set. This game.
General recommendation is because, again, it's one of those, it's not for everyone kind of deals. I got to give it a try it. But for people who are into survival horror games, this has got to be on your radar. It's just, it's creepy. It is spooky. It doesn't hold your hand. And just the atmosphere and the visuals and just the overall general creepiness of the game, it's worth grabbing.
Oh, so, I love the picture of the actual game, like the game art.
Oh, it's beautiful.
So done.
And the in-game visuals too, it's pixel art, but it looks really good. Like, it's not 8-bit pixel graphic.
I didn't even know that it was pixel from these screenshots. It looks like it's just like drawn.
Yeah, it is really, really good stuff. But again, not for everyone, because bitches will cry like you.
I mean, a general whore analysis.
QQ more, pussy. Anyway, next game to talk about is called Safety First, developed by JCO, published by Headup Games. This released September 8th on Steam for $2.99. Safety First is a twin-stick physics puzzler in which you have to fix broken electric wires using your magic yellow repair liquid. Can you beat all 69 levels? CJ, tell us about this one.
All right, it's absurdly odd, and it's really unique for a I've never even heard of a twin-stick platformer before.
This is the third game in a row that we could just legitimately say this game is fucked up.
It is, but it's in a different... Every game is in a different way that it's fucked up. This one is just, like, weird. The twin-stick platforming is a little weird. I know it's an odd idea, so let me explain it. You're in control of a robot that needs to fix power... wires, now that I know that. I thought they were outlets. With your repairing juice, which is what I called it, which you expelled through your body from your robotic penis.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
You're basically pissing on wires.
Exactly.
But you're a robot, so it's repair liquid. From a dispensing nozzle or something.
This one, I'm actually reading the review I wrote because I wrote it so well. You control your legs with the analog sticks, left stick controlling the left leg and the right stick controlling the right leg. And then once you've positioned your legs correctly, press A and piss on, repair the outlet. But that's not where it stops. The controls are aggravating. And so this turns into a rage game as well. And you'd expect that from a game like this. I mean, if you're a fan of like Quap, or
I was gonna say it's basically twin stick analog quap.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing the game says as soon as you launch it is, by all means, use a gamepad, and you get an achievement for that. If you use a gamepad, you actually get an achievement in the game. So they do not want you to use a keyboard or mouse, and I don't know if that would even be possible.
Eternal Rage, twin stick platforming, the hell. You don't even know.
Yeah. You should be looking on this at this on Steam right now.
Twin stick quap platforming.
Yeah. If you use both legs and hold up with both sticks, you can actually fly. And flying is needed on a lot of levels, but can be aggravating because your legs seem to have a mind of their own. And sometimes they'll just go and move off to the side. And the problem with that is if they move too far away from your body, they'll actually detach and you'll start bleeding. Robotic red blood. And die.
Clearly oil.
Oh, yeah. Red oil, obviously. My fault. And also seems like all the floors are made of ice. You slide all over the place. You have a limited amount of juice per stage, and some stages allow you to have a little bit more than you need, while others are like very stingy and you only get exactly how much you need. And if you run out, don't worry. You could just kill yourself by pressing X and restart. You're all right.
Your head just fucking pops off.
It does. And yet again, achievement.
Yeah.
That's a fucked up achievement. The game is pretty forgiving in some aspects, though. If you fail a stage 5 times, you can just cheat and skip the level, which is awesome. So they don't take the game too seriously. They're just like, have fun, play through the game, and if you can't do it, well.
Let's remember, there's 69 stages in the game.
There is. 30 regular, 30 advanced, and 9 space levels. Space, you have no gravity, and it's literally impossible. I can't do the first level.
Oh, fucking,
I did the training.
The fucking space levels, Jesus Christ.
God damn. Luckily, the game marks which stages you cheat on, so you don't have to keep track, and you can always just go back and replay them at any point. There's also 3 random game modes. Well, not random, but there's 3 versions of the game. You know, your first is normal, which, you get right away. Then you unlock pep mode for completing 10 stages. You actually have to beat these stages. You can't cheat. But it counts like any 10 stages. So you can do 1 through 9 and then do 15, but it skips the rest and it still gives you it. And pep mode makes everything move stupidly fast and is incredibly more difficult. Somehow they made it more difficult with fast electronic music playing in the background instead.
Did y'all raid a schizophrenic's gaming wish list? Oh, you know... We're gonna change directions even more after this one.
The speed is just ridiculous. I couldn't do one level with this one. The other mode is by far the greatest thing that's ever been added to a game ever. It's called DRNK or drunk without a U. And it makes the screen go like side to side slowly and, changes your head from, to have a ski mask on it. And then you start swearing in German when you're messing up or you're getting hurt. And it's hilarious. Scheiße, scheiße. That's just, you keep hearing that over and over again with some absolutely ridiculous, like stupid, death metal. Like people just screaming like, and it's just, it's absolutely ridiculous. At first I didn't even really enjoy the game that much. It was like, this is interesting, but it's kind of like not really that great. I unlocked this mode and I was like, all right, I get it. I like it. This is for me now. I think that everybody will have their own game mode that they like. Like some people are like playing normal. Some, ridiculous people that see in faster vision than we can even imagine will enjoy pet mode. And, dumb people like me will enjoy drunk mode.
The masochistic people will enjoy pep mode.
Yeah, I don't know. The music was absolutely awful in the drunk mode, but it was still hilarious to listen to.
See, the first time I started the level and I moved the analog sticks and saw how the game controlled, I was like, this game is genius. It's the dumbest thing, but it is genius.
I also like all the references they made. Like, one of the achievements, if you retry a level 10 times in a row, you get the achievement called Dark Souls. it's so creative. I like the achievements in the game. Something that wasn't game related, but I found funny was also the publisher commenting in the Steam forums with hilarious trolling answers.
Like, this one. I didn't see that.
Oh my god, you missed it. Like, this one dude was just like, why? Just why? And they responded with, we don't dare to answer this. It's just like, I can always get behind a company that's having fun with their product.
Oh, so my God.
It's just even more of a reason. Overall, for $2.99, why the hell not? Just get it and have some stupid fun.
Yeah, this I agree. This one is a buy it because it's just so fucking stupid.
It's $2.99. I mean, what the hell? It's not bad. Oh, my God. Null Pulse is here and he said my name.
Oh my god. I love the fact that they're, yeah, we don't dare to answer this. I double dare you, 42.
Yup. They're just having fun. I like that.
Yeah, the dudes at Headup Games have been awesome. So I am. Is this game Reason to Live? Oh my god, I have to read these answers.
Yes, those are great.
Yes, this game is the meaning of life. And then Head Up Game says, and the answer to all other questions, life, the universe, and everything. I feel illuminated. Thanks, Master.
It's just the fun that they have is great.
See, I love it when developers and publishers just remember that games can be stupid fun.
Exactly. And then they don't overcharge. Like, this game at $2.99 is the absolute perfect price for this.
It is such a fantastic impulse buy, and even if you play it for 10 minutes and laugh your ass off and never touch it again, you got your money's worth.
Especially with the fucking cards on Steam, you could get this game for free.
Yeah.
It's not that bad. It's worth it.
Just the fucking legs ripping off.
Oh, it was so aggravating. I was yelling at the game, but I was enjoying it.
The first time the legs ripped off, I was like, just popped right off.
That did not say anything about it in the game description. I did not expect that it happened.
The game, as we mentioned, was called Safety First with an exclamation point.
And you'll notice it by the picture that is of a blurred robot penis.
It's so fucking stupid.
I fucking loved it.
I love that we've done just a whole bunch of fucked up games in a row.
Yeah.
Like,
researching on Steam now.
Yeah. And just because we've had such a weird lineup of games so far, let's make things even weirder. The next game to talk about is called NASCAR Heat Evolution. developed by Monster Games, published by Dusenberry Martin Racing, released September 13th for $59.99, provided to us by Dusenberry Martin Racing, which, you know, we pretty much only cover games that are provided to us because we're cheap bitches. But they wanted us to mention that, so they provided it to us, and we thank them for it. For the first time this console generation, race is your favorite NASCAR Sprint Cup Series drivers across all 23 licensed NASCAR tracks in stunning HD with incredibly detailed environments. Get ready for the most fun you've had with a NASCAR game in years. Whether you're a casual racer or a diehard sim fan, NASCAR Heat Evolution will adjust to your skill level with a brand new AI and speed rating system that applies the right amount of challenge for you. Or you can be like me and just drop it all the way down to easy for a couple of races and beat the shit out of everyone.
I mean, that's how I live my life. Easy is the only way.
A couple of different modes into the game. There is standard, do a race and then move on. There are challenges which you can unlock through playing the career mode and through the championship mode, which you have a choice between like 6, 12, 24, or like the entire Sprint Cup series. There's also the race to the cup that you do like the final 10, 12 races, whatever it was. I did it last night and I don't even remember that you do the final section of races and then you try and win the Sprint Cup at the end. And again, those unlock the challenges you could play. And then there's career mode, which has a lot of potential, but also a lot of aggravation. In career mode, which I've spent the most time on, you create your own driver. First off, I love the character model for the character creation. I actually wish that they used the models that you create a lot more than just like standing next to your car, because I really enjoy the look of it. Like I wish there was, they just used it more. But it's basically just in between the races. You're standing there.
Well, I mean, I gotta look at that. The car, the creation.
Yeah, I mean, it's nothing like super magical. I just enjoy the style of it. Like, it has a kind of a realistic cartoony look, which I thought it was a good look, and I wish the avatars were used more than just in between the races. In career mode, you basically start as a brand new driver with like no sponsors, no nothing, and you have to work your way up the ranks. So when you first start playing career mode, you're not going to win like at all. I've been through like 2 years in career mode, and I think my best place was a 10th.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. Like, it is brutal, and, like, this was on easy difficulty, so I'm scared to see how it would be, like, on hard. Like, there
are, you've been wrecked out. First lap. Have
fun. Thankfully, you can turn damage off. Like, you can either have sim damage, or, like, I just switched it off, because, you know, it's a NASCAR game. It, you know, if you're not rubbing, you're not racing.
Oh, but it's so fun to see the wrecks.
Yeah, it's fun wrecking people. So, I've done that quite a bit.
Oh, do they still take damage? You just don't?
No, you don't, like, they don't get damage, but you could still slam into people and spin them out.
Oh, well, yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it was always, like, it would be awesome to just actually leave the damage on and just potentially just screw everybody else up enough that, that you become first just by automatically winning.
I would love a new Destruction Derby game, by the way. That would be fantastic.
NASCAR Destruction Derby.
That would be awesome. But yeah, I kind of wish the career mode was a little more forgiving. You obviously can unlock upgrades as you progress through to give you, you know, more speed, more grip, more horsepower, stuff like that. But it takes so friggin' long to earn enough to get upgrades. Like, through my first year in career mode, there are 4 different garage upgrades you could get, and then each garage upgrade allows you to get 4 new car upgrades. Through my first full season of career, I had 1 garage and 4 of the upgrades.
Ooh. And did you get any sponsors during that period?
Yeah, I, like, pretty much after your first race, you get your first main sponsor. And then after a couple of races, you could get a secondary sponsor, which you get extra money based on, like, you can set the sponsor to give you money for, you know, finishing in the top 30, top 25, top 20. But if you don't make that mark, you don't get paid. You don't get that money from the sponsor.
Then you only got to beat three people.
Well, no, there's only 40 racers in it, so.
Oh, okay. I'm just basing it off normal NASCAR where there's only like 43.
I don't fucking know. Yeah, there's only 40 racers in the game. I wish the career progression was a bit faster. Luckily, you don't have to have ridiculously long races because they let you, there's a lot of flexibility in how long you can set your races to be. Like the lowest is 2% of a race. So something that might have like 267 laps, you have to do like four.
That's okay. So it's just like a basic racing game at that point.
Yeah.
If you're doing that one.
Or if you're really, really ballsy, you can set it to do the entire fucking race.
Oh, that'd be so fun. I love doing that shit. Like in Forza 5, I'd set 50 lap races because that's the max they'd allow you. And I would just go around and with my friends on the track and just, oh my God, this sounds like that's great.
Yeah. Last night, there's an achievement in the game for racing a 100% race, and there's one for winning a 100% race. So, of course, I went for it. It took me 2.5 hours.
That seems realistic.
Yeah. So, the people who really want to race forever in the game, you can. Good for you. You can race.
I'm happy they put that in.
Literally forever.
I think that is fucking awesome that they put that in.
And then you can also customize it whether you want to do, like, quick qualifying, full qualifying, if you just want to skip qualifying completely. Although, if you do that, you're pretty much always going to start in 40th. So, it's an uphill battle all the time. But even if...
I hate qualifying, though.
I know. Even, like, when I was doing the qualifying, I was still 40th.
Oh, well, then maybe just skip it.
Yeah, so for the most part, I just skipped it and went with the races. Visually, the game looks good. It's like the cars seem kind of boxy, and especially in how they move, things seem kind of, you know, they just seem kind of boxy. If you spin out or if you flip, if it happens, which it's actually happened to me a few times, it just feels like the car doesn't move, really. It just, like, the graphic flips upside down.
Oh.
Like, there's no twisting and turning to the car. It's just a very static car. The environments look pretty good. I wish there was, you know, after you do a 2.5 hour race, I wish the friggin' clouds were in a different position, at least. So it's, things don't really change as you go through it, but it looks decent enough. I'm not going to gripe about the visuals. They were fine.
NASCAR games have never really been anything special in that term.
Yeah. I mean,
and I think this is their first one.
Yeah. This is, Dusenberry's first foray into it. So I think for a first time, they did pretty well. I do have one major gripe with the game, and that is with the audio. There is a spotter that basically, you know, as you're driving, you're going to have a spotter telling you if there's a car on your left or on your right or whatever else. I think the spotter that they got for the game, they recorded literally 12 lines of dialogue and that's it.
Oh, God, I hate when games do that.
Yeah, so when you're racing, if you're next to a car, every 2 seconds you're going to hear, still there, still there, still there.
Can you just turn it off?
No.
Oh, God.
You cannot turn the spotter off. So I just snapped TV. And I have my main game to just, you know, the main window to not have any audio. And I just had TV playing while I raced. In the championship, when I did the full race, I don't know if the spotter would eventually tell you, hey, you're running low on fuel. You're going to need to pit soon. Like, you could keep an eye on things, but I don't know if there were warnings because I didn't want to fucking hear still there, still there, still there. It drove me insane. I had to mute the game completely because I couldn't turn off the spotter.
Oh, God. That sounds horrible.
Yeah, it's Jesus fucking Christ. It was irritating.
I also heard you notice only mentioned the Sprint Cup. Did they not include the Xfinity?
I think it's just Sprint.
Oh, that's also a little bit disappointing, but okay.
I mean, there's still plenty of content in the game.
Yeah,
there are 23 tracks. There's, you know, all the different settings for career and for championship. $60 price tag, I think, is kind of high for this. I wish it was a little bit lower. I think 40 or 50 would have been a better price overall for it. But if you're looking for a good arcade racer, like this, there are some sim elements in the game if you want it, but for the most part, this is going to be one of those games where 90% of the game you're holding down the trigger and just driving as fast as you can.
Well, that's what NASCAR is, basically. Yeah,
some turns you're going to ease up on it so that you don't take the turn too sharp and slam into the wall. But for the most part, this is just balls out fast racing, and it's fun. It grew on me a lot more as I played it, and I've just been, I would have been like, yeah, I played enough of this game to base my opinion and review it, and I'm like, yeah, fuck it, I'm going to do a 267 lap race because why the fuck not?
Yeah. I am thoroughly surprised it was $60. I actually thought it was 40.
Yeah.
I thought it was like $39.99.
So, for most people, I would say it might be best to wait for a sale. But if you have that itch and you're just dying to play a NASCAR game and, you know, you want to be Dale Earnhardt or Joey Logano or Danica Tony Patrick
Stewart. Or whoever.
Or if you want to run Tony Stewart off the goddamn road because he's an asshole.
You got a fucking clip for that. Did you actually record that, or was that an automatic game?
I recorded that manually, and I edited that to have a nice 8-second clip of me T-boning Tony Stewart, because fuck him.
Why do you hate him so much? That's my dad's favorite racer.
Because he's a dickhead. He murdered someone. Let's not forget that Tony Stewart killed a man.
Okay, but the dude went on the track. On it. That dude fucked up, not Tony.
Tony Stewart killed a man. Let's not forget that. Let's never forget that.
But it was the dude's fault.
Plus, he looks like my mom's ex-husband, my former stepdad, and he was a piece of shit, so he's guilty by association.
Oh, okay. I get it. Yeah, now.
Tony Stewart and Tony Bove can go fuck themselves. How about that?
Damn, bro. That's some strong statements. I do not agree with the SML podcast statements on that, his own opinions.
all the statements made on this show are mine and mine alone, and the show is mine and mine alone, so those are the official statements of the SML podcast.
Well, I don't agree with this.
Overall, yeah, I gotta give the game a try. It was a lot more fun than I expected. Like, my first impressions were kind of mediocre, but the more I played it and the more I got into it, it grew on me, and I really, really enjoyed my time with it by the time I was done. And I'm probably gonna play it a lot more for the next 5 days until Forza Horizon 3 is out, and then honestly, I'm not going to play anything else ever. So.
The demo was so good.
I know.
I have to get $60 for that game or win it somehow on Twitter. I need it.
Well, if you're only saving up $60, you have until next Tuesday, but I'm getting it on Friday because I need my Ultimate Edition.
What, do you get extra, like an early access if you buy the Ultimate?
Yeah. You get it on Friday instead of Tuesday.
Oh, fuck, man. That sounds awesome.
But you gotta get the $100 Ultimate Edition that comes with the season pass and the VIP.
Exactly, it's worth it.
Absolutely fucking worth it. Goddamn right. Yeah, be like Eternal. Win all the games.
I've won one thing on Twitter in a whole month. I won two things, but one of them was a fake giveaway that just ripped me from $15. And the other one was, I won Dangerous Golf last night for Steam.
Also, now I need to go Google Tony Stewart killed a guy.
God damn it. Holy shit.
Oh, that's awesome. But yeah, NASCAR Heat, it was fun. I had a blast with it. So if you're looking for a good arcade racer, check it out. Again, I wish the price was a little bit lower, but it was fun game.
It's not as bad as Adam's Venture.
Yeah, Adam's Venture should have been a $20 game. But yeah, I still enjoyed NASCAR Heat Evolution. And thanks again to Dusenberry Martin Racing for allowing us to check out that game. good stuff. Really enjoyable stuff.
Yeah, he did really kill somebody. That is true.
Yeah, he did.
You know, it wasn't on purpose.
No, it wasn't on purpose. Well, I don't think the killing was on purpose.
The running him over multiple times after was. But the first hit was on... Was
yeah, he hit him on purpose. I don't think he meant to kill him, though. But let's not ignore the fact that Tony Stewart killed a guy.
God damn, bro.
He did. He killed a guy. That is a fact. His actions killed a guy.
So if you kill a guy, I'm allowed to bring that up multiple times then next time.
Yeah.
On the show.
I killed the hopes and dreams of my wife. That is something I have done. She had a bright future, and I murdered her future.
So basically, you killed her with that.
Yes. Yes.
You may not have killed her, but you ended her life.
Basically, yes. And now she takes care of 8 cats and a fat-ass husband.
Oh, God, the worst nightmare.
When Joe was in Reno, he killed a man just to watch him die. Man, I wish I went to Reno. I'd love to go to Vegas and Reno. And
it would almost be worth it to kill a guy and watch him bleed just to go to Reno.
Probably. That and the legal prostitution.
Oh, shit, is it legal there?
In Nevada.
Oh, shit, I'm moving. I don't have money for games. How am I going to have money for women?
Oh, man. All right, next game. Let's move on from murdering men because of Tony Stewart. And let's talk about WanderjahR, developed by Workyrie. God damn, I hate companies that have crazy names. Workyrie.
I mean, the name of the game is crazy. What do you mean?
Workyrie Game Studio, published on the PlayStation Vita by Corecell Technology. It released August 31st on the Vita for $9.99. It released on Steam earlier in the year. WanderjahR is a JRPG with real-time combat and an intriguing story featuring a new battle system blending RPG and strategy, a style of Japanese animation graphics, and the unforgettable story. WanderjahR delivers the next step of real indie games. This is a weird, interesting game. I wouldn't really call it a JRPG because it's not like you're wandering a map and, you know, visiting towns and everything else. This is very much it has a very mobile-ish feel to it. Where
yeah, I can tell from the screenshots. But I mean, I guess that's kind of designed like that for the PS Vita as well. Yeah.
It has a very touch-oriented game. Basically, you start a level and you can have up to 4 people in your party. As you start, it just gives you 1 and you earn new party members as you go. There's like the attacker, the defender, the healer, the buffer, the debuffer, magic attack of different elements, a ranged attack. So you are constantly, depending on the enemies that you're fighting, you're constantly having to micromanage and switch in and out the members who are there.
That's cool.
You are not actually doing any of the attacking. All the characters are auto attacking based on like an active time gauge. And as, you know, their gauge is up, they'll perform their action. Like, the defender will shout to get the enemies to attack him. The attacker will attack. The healer will heal. Everything, stuff like that. It all comes down to swapping out the characters based on what the battle requires. When I started out the game, I was having a really, really fun time with it. But this game, it doesn't have difficulty spikes. It has difficulty brick walls.
Build a wall.
Pretty much. I went through the first couple of stages. I would grind a little bit, get to the max level. Like, you can only increase your max level. It has like a hard cap until you beat a boss and move on, and then the cap goes up. So if you hit that cap and you're having trouble with the boss, you're kind of fucked. There's nothing else you can do except just keep trying and hope you luck out or whatever else. I'm going to talk about the first boss because this is the one that I had the first, like, brick wall problem with. The first boss is 3 enemies, which basically one is a hard attacker, one is kind of like the debuffer, and then one is a healer.
And God, enemy healers are the worst.
And I don't just mean, like, a heal part of the life. I mean, when you have your enemy down to like a tiny sliver of health left, because They have health, and then they have, like, a defense gauge. As you attack it with magic and physical attacks, that, like, the physical attacks mainly go after health, but they'll chip away at the defensive gauge. Magic attacks primarily hit the defensive gauge. You need to have, like, you can't have two magic, two spellcasters, because the gauge will just fill up. Physical attacks make it stop filling briefly. So you basically have to have a physical attacker and a magic attacker working down that defensive gauge, and then you can have the physical attacker just, you know, chip away at the health until the defense gauge rebuilds completely and it's full power once again. But as it's building, you're just taking away at the health. Considering there is a debuffer who is constantly forcing your physical attacker to be weakened, so your attacks do, like, jack shit damage. Yeah. You are continually having to swap, like, rotate characters. So pull out the defender and put something in so that the defender could be swapped out for the physical attacker who had, like, no strength, and then put the physical attacker for, like, the dummy one that you just threw in briefly, and then hope that you can do enough damage. And also hope that the fucking healer doesn't cast full heal.
Oh my god.
Not that's... partial, full heal. 100% full health.
Oh, that's fucked.
The one time that I tried the boss battle, I had the one enemy full healed three times.
Oh.
I spent over a half hour on this battle.
I hate battles that the boss can heal at all.
Yeah.
And full... God, that's awful.
It was maddening to hit that brick wall, and, you know, it was just a struggle. And from there, the battles, they just got super, super long. Like, the first couple of battles in the game, it's like, oh, I completed this one in 2 minutes. Cool. It's like, oh, I completed this one in 4 minutes. Cool. The boss was like, I want to say the time I finally completed it was like 12 minutes.
God. Hey, that's a battle in its own.
Yeah, and then the next world, you would start, you know, there's like world 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, 1-4, 1-5, and then 1-6 was the boss. 2-1 was like the goal time was like 10 minutes.
So it just, it like goes up hard right there.
Yeah. I mean, the gameplay is fun, but there's just so many balancing issues that I wish there were a lot of changes to the game. I wish the battles themselves weren't so long, and I wish that the difficulty spikes weren't as ridiculously difficult. That just that first boss battle killed so much of my joy of the game. Because, you know, there's the healer. If you try attacking the healer first, the attacker does, like, super heavy attacks to you. Like, don't touch him. Half your health is gone.
So basically, oh my god, those, I know exactly what you mean because I played a different game that I'm not going to say again, even though I've already mentioned it before and I fucking hate it that I played it so much. Same shit happened where if you would attack a specific enemy, then, the boss would be like, don't attack that. And he'd either like put on like special stuff or he'd hit you with the super attack.
Yeah.
And it's just like, bullshit. Come on.
And it sucks because I was enjoying the game so much. I was really enjoying the unique battle to it. It's more of a strategy game because you have to swap in the characters. It's not so much an RPG, but I really enjoyed the real-time combat mixed with the strategic swapping in characters. But the difficulty spikes and the difficult, just the length of some of those battles, it really put a damper on it. I mean, the game is still fun, but I gotta be kind of a hesitant try it.
I'd say they really just need to knock down, like, especially for the first boss, because that's too early in the game to put it up.
It needs
the full heal.
It needs to be rebalanced. If they rebalance this game and address some of the issues with it, I can see this being an incredibly fun, long-lasting game. But as it is, it's really frustrating, but before that, it was really enjoyable. So
I'm surprised you didn't tell me it was on 3DS, too.
Is it on 3DS?
I said I'm surprised you took.
Oh,
it was like it wasn't. I was like,
yeah,
this game looks like the perfect 3DS game.
It probably would work really well on 3DS. I don't know what they would do with the top screen because it's so touch intensive. But man, this is one of those games where I wish I could give it a better rating, but there's just so many annoyances that I really hope they go back and address it. I hope they patch it and fix some of the issues and some of the gripes, because it has so much potential. It really does.
Yeah, that sucks.
It's a hesitant try. It for $10, it's not like it's going to be a wallet breaker, but there's problems with it. And
the graphics look cute. I like
It's an adorable game, and it's fun. But it's brutal.
Yeah.
And even worse is that there were issues with the release where for like over a week after the game came out, people who bought it from the PlayStation store could not download it.
Oh, really? Was that just a PlayStation side of things? Yes. Or was it?
It was something to do with, you know, I don't know if the file was uploaded wrong or what the hell happened, but it took, I think, just about a week or a little over a week before people were able to download the game. Like, I redeemed the code and I went to the game on the store and it would not allow me to install it.
I'm surprised, seeing as you got a review copy. Normally,
I know.
Review copies allow you to play the game early anyway.
Yeah.
You'd think you would have been able to.
It wasn't just me. Pretty much everyone who had a code for it or everyone who bought it. And it was an American thing too, because apparently in Europe there were no issues.
Oh, that sucks. So it's just American PlayStation Store. Yeah.
I mean, the issue is taken care of, so there's no problem getting it now, but whatever fuck-up there was when it came out, another inconvenience, but I can't fault the game itself for that. That's probably,
And it's possible that the PlayStation Store was fucked up and not, like, they messed up when uploading it.
Yeah.
It could have been the PlayStation Store having problems.
Yeah.
But again, you know how reliable that thing is.
Oh, I won't even get started. But yeah, hesitant, try it. If they patch it and fix it up, I will gladly revisit the game and check it out again. I hope they do, because it has so much promise and so much potential.
Well, you can always hope.
Yeah. Final game to chat about. Super Treasure Arena, developed by Vennril, published by Headup Games. Headup once again. Released,
God, they're so good.
Released August 15th on Steam Early Access for $7.99. Super Treasure Arena is a unique mix of retro-inspired arcade action and objective-based arena shooters. The result is a frantic game where collecting and stealing loot from your opponents is the key to victory. CJ, tell us about it.
It's fun. It's a lot of multiplayer is the main focus of this game. You can either play locally with up to four players on the single computer, or you can do online, which is amazing. Thank you for including online, because there's too many games now that's like, I mean, I understand that there's not online because it's too expensive to program that, but and they did a good job with it. Like, the online does not lag. It's great. They have set up the online so nicely that it's actually a lot of fun to play it online with, like, me and you actually played this game together.
Yep.
For a little while. Cause they were nice enough to give us two codes for this.
Yep.
Which is very cool of them.
Thanks to Headup for that.
Headup is such a good publisher, not developer. I don't know if they ever did develop a game.
No, they've been awesome to us, so shout out to them.
I like them. The game is pretty fun though to actually play. It's a top down kind of like Diablo-ish style, like the way it looks with the camera. But it's twin stick as well. So you're like shooting each other using, different weapons. There's like six different weapons in the game. And all of them are pretty useful except for your beginning weapon, which you start out with, is like a sword or whatever. It's just melee. But it's very easy. You spawn with another weapon next to you, and the weapons are random. So you could either get really good and get, like, the bomb arrows that are very powerful, or you could get really unlucky and just get a regular bow or, like, the cannonballs. The cannonballs are powerful, but a little hard to manage.
I liked the regular bow.
I didn't like it. It's fast. It's fast as hell, but it's weak.
I didn't care that it was weak because I just chipped away at you like a motherfucker.
I didn't want to bring this up, but yes, Joe beat me every game. Except the one game we tied, which was the other game. I didn't want to bring that up. I was fucking awful.
You think I was going to let you not bring that up, that I whooped your ass at the game?
You did. You did.
Even on the one where, like, you killed me at the last minute and stole all the money that I dropped and the game ended and I was like, oh, you got me that time. I still somehow beat you by two.
Yeah. But a lot of the times you beat me right at the end because you would kill me and take all my damn coins. And then you'd be like, oh, I have 30 more coins than you now. That's awesome.
Defense, motherfucker.
Because the game works, you have a 3-minute time limit, and you'd try to collect as many coins as possible by killing either little random NPC enemies that are just like there to kind of annoy you.
Little dickhead goblins and slimes.
Yeah, all those slimes are, some of them are hard to see too, and so sometimes you'll just be like wandering around and be like, what the heck is hitting me? Oh my god, I died from a slime.
Pretty much.
But you collect coins from that, and then treasure chests will spawn every so often. And you break those open using your weapons, and they have a lot of coins and a healing potion that gives you, 50 health. So if you're getting attacked and you picked up one of those, you're back to basics.
Yep. And then when you die, you drop half your money.
Oh, my God.
It sprinkles everywhere on the map, and if no one picks it up within so long, the money disappears.
So a lot of the times you don't have a chance to get back. You can't get back to your own unless you spawn right next to where you died. You're not going to get back to your own coins. You're going to lose them if nobody picks them up anyway.
Yeah. I don't know how many times I died from an enemy and you weren't around. So all that money just disappeared.
And it was like, damn it. I wish the money would stick around a little bit longer, but I understand.
Hey.
That game mode was definitely my favorite one. The coin collection.
Yeah.
The other game mode was a little bit less fun and the only one that I actually tied with you. And it basically requires you to grab a treasure chest that's in the middle and then you want to take that back to your own base. But while you have it, you're very slow. So that gives the other player a chance to kill you and take the treasure chest.
And the enemies to chip away at you really quickly.
Yeah, because the enemies are surprisingly quick with how much they can kill you. Because they take 10 health each time, which doesn't seem like that much when you have 100. But then they just start smacking you like 10, 10, 10, 10, 10. Like, damn, bro, calm down. The game's a lot of fun, though. I mean, me and you played it for a little while, and we had a good time. I then went and played it against AIs to see how they played. Surprisingly, well-balanced AIs. I enjoyed it. They did a good job of making them not too difficult, but not too easy that you beat them every single time. So I don't know if there's a difficulty in the game. I didn't see one. I don't think you can actually set a difficulty, but they seem well done. I also enjoyed the different characters in the game, which there isn't much of a difference because all the weapons are on the ground. But you do have a different ability in each character.
Yeah, like the warrior puts up a shield that he has for a bit. The mage freezes the enemy for a little bit. The archer shoots out like a giant.
No, the mage doesn't do that. That's the mystic.
Oh, the mystic.
The mage does fire ball, like the little placements, and then the fire comes from the ground.
Mm.
It kills anybody around it. The mage one is interesting against CPUs because they're stupid and they'll walk into it. But but for like you just know to walk around it. So the mage is kind of useless in that section. And then there's the rogue who shoots like an arrow.
Like a giant ass arrow.
Yeah, super powered arrow. It's pretty cool. You kept playing the damn warrior and using the shield. And the shield is so aggravating. It's like you can't do anything at that point.
Yeah, even better was I would use my shield and then you would use your ability to freeze me and I had my shield up, so it did shit.
Yeah, because I preferred the mystic because the freezing, especially in the treasure chest one, that freezing was absolutely critical. That's how I was able to score my points. Because I would just freeze you and then you'd be like, well, I can't do anything. I'm watching you just score.
Yeah.
that's the only reason we tied.
Yeah. I do have a bit of a gripe with the game. I wish there was more to it. I know it's early access, and I'm sure they'll add more modes and stuff to the game, but I kind of hope, like, games like this, I wish they had some kind of campaign to it. I understand that it's an arena-style game and a, like, a local and online versus kind of game, but I wish there was more to it. But
I could easily see them doing, like a tournament mode, at least.
Yeah.
It kind of allows you to, kind of like Unreal Tournament wasn't really a story, but just, you play through a tournament.
Yeah.
I think that'd be cool for this game to have like a tournament mode, so that at least it feels like you're doing something outside of just playing.
Yeah, but you know, for early access and what's there for $8, I think it's a blast.
Especially
with online. Online is the saving grace for this thing.
If it was just another local co-op, I'd be like, "There's nothing special here." But online is like, there just needs to be more online in games.
Yeah, and especially with how well it worked.
Yeah, it was really good. Like, they made sure that game did not lag at all. And yeah. I'm not sure if maybe it was like going off of one of us, like we were hosting it, or if they actually have their own servers for it. But either way, we had a great time. There was no lag. I was getting my ass kicked. I wish there was lag on his side so that he could have died more.
But bitch.
He'd steal all my coins.
Bitch.
It was really frustrating.
Got your ass kicked.
I definitely say if you have some friends to play this game, buy it. If you don't really have anybody to hang out with or that you know will get the game, and you're only going to be playing against like bots or random people, it might only be like a try it.
I think it's definitely, if nothing else, worth definitely keeping your eye on, because this has a lot of potential in it.
Yeah, exactly. If they add more game modes, this will definitely increase how much it's worth it. Because it's like, it just needs more game modes, honestly. That's the only problem I had.
The glory of early access. We'll see what gets added as it goes through. But for what's there right now, I dig it. It's good stuff. Definitely try it.
Definitely.
So yeah, those are six games. A lot of big fucking variety of games.
Also, really weird week. The only ones that seemed normal games were like Super Treasure, you know, maybe NASCAR and the one you just reviewed. Even that one's weird. The fucking weird ass name.
WanderjahR.
So I'll say that's weird. Yeah, I'll say that's weird too.
I like that we went from a fucked up Kinect game to a fucked up survival horror game to a fucked up robot pissing game to NASCAR. Like, it's just such a weird lineup, this show.
Every single game was a completely different type of game. It was pretty cool.
Part of me kind of wishes that we did include Plantera, but I gotta save that for Chris to see what kind of Pantera puns he could give.
Yeah, because I don't know anything about them.
Yeah. That'll be on a later episode. No worries.
Yeah, I'll listen to it and then I'll be like, oh, okay. I get it now.
Respect the fact that we're doing that on a different episode.
I'm down for you guys to fuck around as much as possible. It gives me more.
Respect. What? What is that?
They glitched an achievement in Rocket League. It doesn't unlock anymore.
Oh, that sucks.
I know. I was so close to completing it. And now an achievement doesn't unlock anymore.
But yeah, that pretty much wraps up what we need to talk about here. So stick around. Got an interview coming up. Clearly not for the people in chat right now, but for the people listening to the episode via YouTube or MP3, stick around after the musical interlude, because we got some music to play. And someone's asking about the Rocket League achievement. So there you go. Some news. Tell us about the glitched achievement.
Okay, so the glitch achievement is one that I think you already have, Eternal. It's the one where you have to either have the Armadillo, which is the Gears of War car, or the Halo car, which is the Hog sticker, and you have to beat the other one in a match. That achievement no longer unlocks.
Fuck, I never got that one.
I know, I didn't either. Like, I had the opportunity. I have had the fucking Armadillo since August, but I haven't found anybody that had that car. The Halo one? And then my friend had it, and he was like, well, I'll just help you out and get you, like, in a private match. So we do it, and then, nothing. And oh, but Eternal, they've introduced trading. So if you find somebody with a certified item, and I've already stole Shiz's, so you have to wait. Shiz told me that once I'm done with it, to give it back, and then he'll probably give it to you. So you can have a certified item through him, because there's trading now.
I haven't played in so long. I don't know what the fuck certified items are.
They're special, like, really rare-ass items. They've also introduced crates into the game.
Jazzy. Yeah, I know we talked about crates on the show, but
it's like, now you have to buy keys and you can't earn them, and it's like, it's TF2 and CSGO all over again.
microtransactions, god damn it.
Yeah, you are missing out. Buy Rocket League. That's the other review. Buy Rocket League.
Which we did review quite a while back on the show.
Yeah, and I'm sure you gave it a buy because it's absolutely worth it.
Of course we did. Chris was excited because he had it on PC, and he was like, man, I can't get it for Xbox. I just don't have the money for it. And I bought it on Xbox, and then like later that week, we got a review copy for it. So I'm like, Chris!
I've never hung out with Chris. We should do that one day where we all just play Rocket League. That'd be fun. Because I've never even talked to the guy. I've just heard him on episodes. And I'm not sure if he's ever heard me on episodes.
I don't know. I don't think he listens to the show.
Wow.
I know I don't. Fuck this show. It's stupid.
Oh, dude, you listen to it constantly.
Only when I edit it. I don't listen to it voluntarily. I don't like the host.
Yeah, I wouldn't either.
Yeah, Chris is excited because I don't know if it'll be this week on the show, this coming week, or sometime after that. We're going to be reviewing the recent updates and DLC for Payday 2 on Xbox One.
Fuck, that's awesome.
Yeah,
I love Payday 2, but I got it on PC where they actually care about it.
Yeah, we're hoping to see that that they put some care into the update and the patch and everything. So Chris and I will be tackling that one at a later date. I know he's been busy lately, but hopefully soon the two of us will get some Payday time and we will give you our thoughts on the updates and all that fun stuff.
Awesome.
So yeah, that's it for now. Stay tuned after the music for our interview with Will Dubé of Thunder Lotus Games talking about Jotun. Really good chat, really awesome game. Cool to hear about all the hand-drawn stuff and all that fun jazz, and he could not confirm any future games, even though I pressured him like crazy. These guys, they're fucking hardcore, man. I can't break them down at all. One of these days, I'm going to get some kind of an exclusive on our show. They'll just fuck up and be like, yeah, it's coming out next week. Oh, shit, I wasn't supposed to say that.
Well, I mean, you got the tiny bits, like the big head mode in Renegade.
Oh, yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, that was cool.
I was excited about that one. So, yeah, I don't know what I'm playing for music. Something's going to play. You're going to hear something, and then people are going to talk, and then you'll hear more something. But, CJ, do you got any final words to end this segment of the show?
Yes, I do. Joe, it's pronounced Jotun, not Jotun.
I know, dick.
We'll be right back.
All right, welcome back, everyone. I am here. I have an interview right now. Will, I'm going to butcher this. Dubé?
Yeah, that's it.
Yes, I got one. I got one. Will Dubé of Thunder Lotus Games. Will, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on the show.
It is a pleasure to have you on. We reviewed Jotun last week, I believe, and really enjoyed the game. Beautiful, beautiful game. And it is a pleasure to welcome you onto the show.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the kind words, and it's really my pleasure to be here.
Oh, it's not your pleasure. Don't worry.
No, it is.
So for the people who don't know what Jotun is, or Jotun, as I was told on your Reddit AMA, it's actually Jotun and not Jotun. For those who don't know what Jotun is, give us the sales pitch.
So I say Jotun because I just don't want people searching Y-O-T-U-N on Google and Steam and stores and stuff. So
okay, we'll go Jotun then.
Myself, I'm already butchering the Old Norse heritage. So, so Jotun's a hand-drawn action exploration game set in Norse mythology. You play Thora, a Viking warrior who died an inglorious death and must prove herself to the gods to enter Valhalla.
Nice. Sounds good. So
Yeah. So we launched on Steam last September, and then just last week we, or however long ago this podcast will air from now, on
mid-November, I'm sure.
Wii U, PS4, and Xbox One as well. So we're super happy to have the game pretty much available anywhere.
Yeah, I was surprised to see it hit the Wii U. It seems like a lot of people aren't really doing things for the Wii U anymore, and it's cool to see someone putting out new content for it.
No, we're really happy. I mean, the Nintendo people have been really fantastic. They gave us a lot of support for the game, and they've been just really great to work with. So we're really happy to be able to get the game onto Wii U.
And how, like, what was the decision behind bringing it to the Wii U? Because a lot of developers these days, they're like, the Wii U, it certainly is a thing that no one's releasing stuff on for, so we're not going to bother with it. What convinced you to go for it?
Well, we want it to be on all the major consoles, basically. It's a great way for us to set up our relationship with Nintendo as well for the future and all that good stuff. And we're just happy to get the game on as many consoles that people want to play games on as possible.
Nice. Very, very good to hear. I know Nintendo fans out there are going to be excited to play this one. So when did you say it came out on Steam?
September 29th, 2015.
Wow. So a year old.
Yeah, it took a while. We're a small team. We're obviously working on some other projects simultaneously, some unannounced stuff. But it took a while. But we made it. We made it, and we released on all three consoles and almost internationally on all of them. So that's like Europe, America, even Japan for PS4. So we're pretty, really, really happy we were able to pull it off.
That's something else you don't see much, where someone launches almost worldwide from an indie game. Usually it's like, yeah, we're going to do it in America, and then when it sells and we actually have money, we'll get it rated elsewhere.
Yeah, it's a big investment and a time investment, because you kind of have to submit to all the different regions. But yeah, it's definitely worth it. You want to be kind of available in as many places as possible at the same time, right? Because that's when the marketing push happens. That's when all the reviews come in. If someone sees an American version review but then can't buy the game because he lives in France, then you're kind of losing out on a sale there. So it's always, I think, in my opinion, better to try and sim launch as much as possible.
Yeah, or I'm on majornelson.com quite a bit, and every now and then you'll see a game release and someone in the comments, one of the top things is not available in New Zealand. Thanks a lot.
Right. Yeah, you need to get it rated through the Australian
Obama
board and stuff. Yeah.
Blame him for everything, I guess.
Yeah, I guess he's the easy scapegoat.
So it's been out.
I'm Canadian, though, so I'm not messing with your American politics, man.
Oh, that's fine. Your prime minister is what? He's like a model. He's the most gorgeous man in Canada.
Yep. He's, I think like right after being elected, he was on the cover of Vogue and stuff. So pretty special.
What's that like up there? Because I can't imagine people being like, ooh, our president of the United States, he's a hunk. Like, no one looked at Richard Nixon and they're like, ooh, look at that stud.
Yeah, yeah, maybe Reagan back in the day because he's such a popular actor. But yeah, no, I don't know. It's good. I mean, it's a good change for Canadian politics. So.
And then on the flip side, you guys also had Rob Ford up there, which got plenty of headlines as well.
Yeah, Montreal though. I'm not from Toronto, so I have nothing to do with that either. I want no
guilty
part
by
of that.
Association.
Yeah, I guess. Well, I guess that makes you guilty for some other craziness going on in American politics right now as well. Then.
Oh yeah, I personally suggested to Donald Trump to run for president.
Ah, perfect. So, well,
that one's all on me. You're welcome.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So what was the reception like for the game when it came out on Steam? I'm going to assume it was pretty decent since you brought it to all the other platforms.
Yeah, it was good. We ended up, I think right now we're sitting at a 79 Metacritic on Steam, about 86% positive reviews on Steam as well, the user reviews. So, I mean, commercially it did well. Critically, it did well as well. So for our first game as a studio, we're so blessed to be in the position we're in right now.
Were you guys affected at all by the new Steam review thing going on?
I think we lost about 30 reviews. Wow. We did Kickstarter, right, back in 2014 for Jotun. We raised $64,000 on a $50,000 goal.
Nice.
And we had 2,300 backers. So, I mean, that kind of tells you, like, how many people actually went out and reviewed the game on Steam when it came out, too. Like, we're on the Humble Store. We're on a Brazilian store as well called Nuvem. So there are some other Steam keys running around being sold outside of Steam. But, it didn't change our rating at all.
Now, that's good to hear. I know someone else that we had on our show, he had like a very positive rating, and after the whole review thing, it dropped him down to like negative.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you don't have a lot of reviews, it's definitely gonna impact you more. I was on Reddit Game Dev on the post about that, and someone was saying that he had like 5 reviews and he lost 4 of them, and then he was 100% negative, which is horrible.
That sucks.
Which is brutal, right? But I don't know. I think it's kind of makes sense. I mean, in a way, Steam is kind of incentivizing developers to want people to buy the game on Steam, therefore making Steam more money, sort of, you know. But I don't think that's why they did it. I think it's good. They're making a lot of really positive changes to the platforms, and you can see it, right? Like the discovery queue, all the different things that Steam are doing is kind of further along than a lot of other players are in the industry are doing right now. And I think they're doing a great job of dealing with the visibility issue.
Yeah, it's such a weird change and such a drastic change for so many developers out there. But it's good to hear that it didn't really affect you guys that much.
Yeah, I mean, it depends on the game, right? If you don't have a lot of reviews and most of them are coming from, you know, friends and family or whatever, then of course it's going to affect you. Even some of the bigger guys like Larian, who do like huge Kickstarter numbers, they have like 42,000 backers on Divinity Original Sin 2. So that's going to have a big impact on them. But I don't know. It's kind of like when they announced the refunds and people went a little, you know, the sky is falling and kind of crazy. I don't really see this having a huge impact either way. I don't know.
Yeah. I guess we'll see. It's something that's going to take time. I'm sure they're going to adjust it as it goes on. But you mentioned you were on Reddit. I've noticed that you guys seem to be very involved with Reddit. You just did an AMA. How did that go for you?
It went good. A lot of us in the studio are Reddit lurkers. A lot of the reasons Reddit is so great is because you don't have a lot of self-promotion, which actually kind of makes it harder though when we want to try and promote the game on Reddit and stuff and such. But yeah, the AMA was a lot of fun. We've done a few Q&As before like that in the past as well. And when you're launching a game, you just want to go into full launch mode, right? You want to try and get the word out as much as possible, talk to as many people as possible, and get as many reviews and as many articles, as many YouTubers, streamers. You just want to try to get everything going, firing on all cylinders for the launch. For us with the console versions, it was actually a challenge for Jotun Valhalla Edition. because it had been so long since our launch on Steam. So it was a really big challenge to kind of build up the hype again, get people excited for the game again, get media excited about the game in order to kind of reach at least a little bit of a critical mass that people are going to hear about the game when it actually launches.
So you mentioned that this is Valhalla Edition. What is the difference between Jotun and Jotun Valhalla Edition?
So back when we did Kickstarter, one of our stretch goals, well, the only stretch goal we hit was the 60K, and part of that was New Game Plus. So Valhalla Edition is one part fulfilling all our promises to our Kickstarter backers, and one part building up excitement for the console launch. So the base game is the same in Valhalla mode, Valhalla Edition, as the regular game. I mean, we've made obviously some fixes over the last year to the experience, but primarily it's the same game. What the additional content is Valhalla mode. So that's our take on New Game Plus. It's a boss rush mode with even harder versions of the already challenging Jotuns.
Yeah, because they are fucking brutal. Like, I have gotten my ass kicked so many times.
Yeah. The Valhalla mode is definitely not for the faint of heart. We actually just had a player like yesterday send us a tweet of him like finishing all the achievements in the game. So Valhalla mode with like zero damage on each boss, zero god powers used on each boss. It's pretty crazy.
That is ridiculous. I can't imagine.
It's like a minute, 2 minutes for each boss, basically. I don't even know how he did it. Like, I don't think I could ever like even get all the achievements in this game because some of them are just really hard. It's a hard thing to balance, right? Like difficulty is not necessarily an easy thing. It's super subjective. We wanted Valhalla mode to be really challenging.
Yeah, I think I got the no god powers achievement on just the first boss, and that's because I didn't know how to use them yet.
right.
So that one was by luck. I tried getting it on a few other bosses, and it wasn't happening. The one with all the dwarves kind of coming at me, I got close.
Is that in just the single player campaign, or is that in Valhalla mode?
Single player campaign.
Yeah, so Valhalla mode, like, bosses are, like, 10 times harder. Like, minimum 10, like, more than that. They're ridiculous.
You're evil.
Yeah, I mean, blame the game designer, right? Like, it's not an easy thing to balance, because in the base game, we wanted them to be hard, you know, but not impossible. We definitely tried to make it fair. We didn't want to do, like, multiple difficulty modes, because that has... It's a whole different can of worms, right? It kind of takes away from your achievement as a player if you have to go down to easy mode and stuff like that. It's kind of a trade-off, right? Everything in game design is a trade-off. But then some people thought the base game was too easy. Like some people who love, you know, Dark Souls and who are just really skilled at those types of boss battles, they thought the game was too easy. And they beat it in like, you know, 2.5 hours, like, yeah, this game was too easy, sucked. So, like, and other people are like, well, I can't even beat your first boss, so the game sucked. You know, like, it's kind of a lose-lose because you can't balance it for everyone.
Yeah, damned if you do, damned if you don't, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. And if you go into something like an easy mode or like a story mode or something like that, you can do that. But then, you know, if you're fighting the first boss and it's hard... And then you're like, ah, screw it. And then you go down to like an easier difficulty setting. It kind of diminishes your achievement, your feeling of achievement as a player, right? Because you know that you didn't like beat the game at how it's supposed to be played kind of thing. So there's a lot of psychology and emotions going on there.
Well, the people who blaze through it, I hate them, all of them. They're all terrible people, and I am envious of their skills.
Yeah, well, it's not easy to impress the gods.
Very true. I have impressed a handful of the gods. Something I enjoyed about the game is, as much as it plays like a hack and slash, there's a lot of exploration, which I really enjoyed. So it's not just wave after wave of enemies. Like, some stages clearly have enemies you gotta hack down. And then others, it's just... exploration and wandering around, and it's beautiful to just wander around.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I think that's that's a strong, it was a very divisive issue for a lot of players. Like, some people found in between the boss fights a bit slow for their tastes, and some people really like that. And I'm glad that you bring up the art style and the music, which the art style, everything's hand drawn. It's all 2D animation, and the hand painted backgrounds and everything. The music was composed, you know, specifically for every moment. So Max, our composer, the composer we work with, he would look at the level and then like go into the studio and record music specifically for that moment. So that just that our goal was to kind of try to emulate what a game like Journey did super well, or to a certain extent Shadow of the Colossus as well.
That's what I first thought of when I played this game, was Shadow of the Colossus.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a huge inspiration for Jotun, obviously. And yeah, I mean, I think on certain parts of the game it really worked. Certain parts of the game maybe were a bit too slow. But overall, I think the experience as a whole, it really worked. As like the action in the boss fights and the exploration, puzzle solving, and a little bit of combat in the exploration levels as well.
Yeah, you mentioned that some people thought it was a little slow. I think one of my only gripes with the game was I wish I moved a little bit faster.
Yeah, I think towards the end of development, we kind of realized that Thor was a bit slow, that maybe the levels were too big. Like the content per square meter wasn't dense enough. And I think that's a fair critique of the game. Like, if you don't like slower games, more almost like walking simulator type games, then you're probably not going to enjoy the exploration aspect of it. But at that point in development, we're just like way too far in to make any changes at that point and stuff. So, I mean, it is what it is, right? Like you said, like some people are going to like that, some people aren't, and that's okay.
Yeah, overall, I still really enjoyed it. I enjoyed the fact that when I would defeat a Jotun, that all the secrets in the level would show up on the map, so I could easily go back and find the ones I didn't find on my own, and some of them are hidden pretty well.
Yeah, absolutely. That's where like the exploration part comes in. If you want to make exploration interesting, you need to have some good carrots, right? For the player to find, you need to have some good stuff. So that's where the god powers, the Ethan's golden apple, the health upgrades come in.
Yeah, and the golden apple on the frozen lake level was a bitch to find for me. It's on the map. I could tell how to get there. I just couldn't find that hidden pathway.
Yeah, at some point, if you go along the rocks on the left side, you'll see like a little patch of snow, which is like a small indicator of there's something else there. But yeah, I mean, that's good, man. I'm happy you had fun finding all the secrets.
I love secrets. You got to find them all, right? It's like Pokemon.
Yeah, absolutely.
Got to catch all the secrets. Exactly. I also loved the frozen lake level for the giant sea monster underneath.
Yeah, that level is inspired completely by Jormungandr, the serpent who encircles the world in Norse mythology. He's one of Loki's children. So everything in the game is based on some piece of Norse mythology. So like our process when creating the levels, the boss fights, everything was like, okay, what's a cool story or a cool myth that exists, and how can we bring that into the game? How can we bring that into gameplay as a level that made sense and that was fun to go through?
Now, I did not get caught by the sea monster, but what happens if you don't move out of the way? Do you die?
You take damage. You get like knocked back a bunch, and you do. There's kind of like this weird thing where, because of like the physics and stuff, if you can kind of get stuck on a platform and then be surrounded by like by water, and you can't get out, and then eventually you'll just kind of die.
That's awesome. But,
yeah.
I kept thinking this time I'm going to let the sea monster eat me just to see what happens, but I kept running out of the way because I'm a pussy. So.
No, that level was fun. It was fun to see people on stream react to that and kind of freak out a little bit over that. It was one of the, like, if you can create tense moments like that, I think it's super powerful.
I've just always been, like, one of my fascinations in life have been sea creatures. It's like, yeah. I'll drive over a bridge with, like, a, you know, just driving over a river, a normal river. And in my mind, I picture, like, what would happen if I just saw a gigantic shadow underneath of just a gigantic monster, sea beast.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And just, yeah, that's like a primordial fear for a lot of people, too. So.
Yeah, just gigantic sea monsters have always intrigued me. Even back to elementary school, me and my friends were hung up on the Loch Ness Monster.
Yeah.
We were big into stuff like that. So seeing that level, that just, like, attacked my childhood, and I loved it. So I'm nerding out on that one a little bit.
Awesome.
Were there ever any thoughts to have a battle with that sea monster?
Yeah, I mean, who knows what happens in Jotun 2, right, if we ever do that.
Is that one of the unannounced games that you're announcing right now?
No. The unannounced games are remaining unannounced.
Ah, damn. Is one of them Jotun 2?
It's unannounced.
I know for the Kickstarter, you guys had plans for a couple of extra Jotuns and Battlefields. Is that something that you would contemplate doing DLC for, or is that something that you would hold for a potential sequel?
Yeah, at this point, we're probably not going to do any DLC. We're kind of happy with Valhalla mode coming as a conclusion for the project. I think with DLC, I don't know, like we considered it, we thought about it. For DLC to really be worth it, you need to have like a big enough player base, right? Because you need to have a lot of value per DLC as well. So it would be a lot of work for us. For to make a Jotun is like probably like two, we never made one faster than in 2 months.
Wow.
So it's a lot of work that goes into that from a lot of people, because like, not only have all the animation, we have to design the Jotun first. What does the Jotun look like? What are his attacks? What does he look like? Then you have to do the animations. You have to put the animations in the game, put the colliders on the feet. So because we're in top down, you could go through the Jotun's legs. All the colliders are drawn onto every frame of the feet. So it's really time consuming. Then you have to debug and you have to get music, sound effects. So it's quite a long process. And for DLC to make sense for Jotun, you know, we'd have to sell it probably around like $5 or so. But if you're selling like one Jotun fight for $5 and the game has five of them and the game is $15, you know, like where's the value proposition there for players and stuff? So
I would drop $5 for another one. That's just me, though. So.
All right. Good to know. It's my market research right now.
There you go. The one guy you're talking to on a podcast would give you $5 per Jotun. So,
perfect. Yeah,
for how big and how intensive the game is with just the hand-drawn animation, I'm honestly surprised you guys are only charging $15 for the game.
Yeah, I mean, we thought about charging $20 instead. It's our first game as a studio. And you have to look at, it's really hard to choose a price point for a game, right? You kind of have to look at your competitors, look at what other people are doing, and then try to make sure that people are, I mean, ultimately, the gamers who buy the game need to be satisfied. They need to feel like, oh, okay, that was definitely worth $15.
Yeah.
So it's really, it's an art more than a science at that point. I mean, we're happy we did $15. I think it's a fair price point for the game. The game isn't perfect. It's certainly, it does certain things really, really well, which I think if you want a really immersive experience, storybook type thing with the big epic boss fights, then this game is definitely for you, and you like Norse mythology and, you know, the art style and all that. But because of, you know, some of the exploration parts in the game, stuff like that, it's not going to appeal to everyone, and that's fine. Like I said before, we're completely okay with that.
Nice. So there's what, five Jotun in the game? Which are the five that made the cut?
What do you mean?
Who are the five? Just because, you know, I'm trying to help our listeners, so they
right, know. Right, right. So the first Jotun in the game is Yara, the nature Jotun. She was based off of what's her name? Is it Njord? I don't remember. But Thor's mother is actually a giant. So we kind of based her off of her. Thor is also the god of oak trees. The second, then the four other Jotuns, you can kind of beat them in the order that you want after the first one. But the suggested order, the first one is Faye. She's the cave Jotun in Nidavellir. Then after that, you have Isa, the winter Jotun, Hagalaz, the storm Jotun, and Conan, the fire Jotun.
I would have been terrible with all of those names.
Yeah, yeah, no.
Except Thor. I could have gotten Thor.
I've had some time with the game, right? So
On the Reddit AMA, I was the one who asked about the pronunciation of some of the names in the game. And what is the name of the hub world?
Ginnungagap.
That's such a great name.
Yeah, no, it's a great word. It's
Ginnungagap.
It's definitely a tongue twister.
First time I saw that pop up, I'm like, I'm never saying that on the show. I'm not even going to try.
Happening. We had a lot of fun and getting to know all these Norse myths. And we did the Icelandic voiceovers as well, which was super cool. And they add such a great touch to the game as well, such a great authentic touch. Icelandic is the closest language to Old Norse that exists today because Iceland is an island, right? So people kind of held on to their language. It didn't really change as much as let's say like Sweden or Norway.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. You guys, I guess, went to be as authentic as you could for modern times.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I was saying, we wanted to take a piece of the mythology or part of the mythology, bring that into the game. The biggest like creative liberty we've taken is that there is no purgatory in Norse mythology. But we thought that'd make a pretty boring game if you just died and then didn't make it to Valhalla, and then that was the end.
Yeah, that would be kind of a blast.
Kind of a bummer, yeah.
So what are some of the Jotun that you wanted to make the cut, but just, you know, because you were limited by timing and schedule, you could only go with the five. Who are like the ones that you really regretted not making it into the game?
No, to be honest, like we didn't even scope out more content because we knew we were so tight on time and we knew the resources we had and everything. So we kind of settled on the five that we thought were pretty good. We usually started from what element we want to do. So obviously, you know, fire and ice, and then you have like the storm and the nature and all that, and we kind of built it out from there. So, for example, Conan, the Fire Jotun, is based very much on Surtur, who's a Jotun in the mythology who leads Ragnarok. Ragnarok is the end of the world, the death of the gods. So Surtur in the mythology, his whole life is spent hammering a blade, creating the perfect blade called the Ragnarok blade. And that's the sword he brings into combat during Ragnarok, leading all the other Jotuns against the gods to kill them. So we always wanted to take like, okay, what's this one thing in the mythology? Not necessarily copy it exactly, but at least really be inspired by it. So Conan the Fire Jotun, that's why when you come up to him, he's hammering away at his sword and he doesn't even care. He doesn't even look at you until you whack him on the toes, right?
I could legitimately listen to you talk about mythology all day.
It's cool, man. The Norse mythology is amazingly creative, crazy, dark, really insane stuff. The creation myth, for example, is the giant Ymir, whose bones became the mountains and hair became the clouds and blood became the rivers. And he like birthed humans from his armpit sweat glands and stuff. It's like crazy, crazy stuff that's so, so cool. And that we really thought that, you know, like, everyone knows about Vikings and about Thor and stuff like that, but there's so much more, so many more interesting stories that can be, that are told through this, the poetic and prose Eddas, which are the texts, of the mythology that exists, that are just really crazy and really awesome. And we knew we had to make a game, kind of to try and give those, stories justice.
And what made you go with hand-drawn art for the game instead of, you know, pre-rendered graphics or 3D models? What made you go with hand-drawn everything?
The primary reason is that those are the artists that I knew. Like, it's kind of a lame reason, but I know some great 2D artists, and it's something that you don't see too often in games too. So it's a great way for us to differentiate, to kind of stand out from the crowd also. We great artists, and then a solid direction.
It is nice to see different art styles than just pixel art coming from indies.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, people want different things, especially in the indie space. I think one of the reasons why people like indie games is because indie games do things differently. They do try innovative things or things that haven't necessarily been done and stuff like that. So I think it's a great way to experiment.
How many times have people asked you about or compared you to the Banner Saga?
A lot. but the Banner Saga is one of the reasons we made Jotun. Was one of the first inspirations, obviously. Banner Saga came out before we did, they did Kickstarter back in 2012 or something. So I can't pretend to say that I didn't know that game existed. but we saw that. We're like, holy shit, that's so cool. We want to do something not like that exactly. But obviously it was an inspiration.
I say bring it on. The more hand-drawn games, the better. It's great to see different art styles, and I kind of hope that the whole hand-drawn animation kind of makes a resurgence, not just in, like, video games, but in actual, like, television and movie animation. Like, I would love to see Disney put out some old-school hand-drawn animation instead of computer everything.
Yeah. I'm sure they'll get back to it at some point. It's just so costly, right? Like, it takes so much time. Everything needs to be drawn. Like, I think Jotun has like 35,000 frames in it.
Wow.
And we kind of like, it's a mix of like traditional animation and like a little bit of puppet animation too. So like kind of like tweening and stuff like that. It doesn't really show too much, but it depends on the animator and on the animator style and stuff. But it does. It takes a lot of time.
I hope you guys just have like a stack of 35,000 drawings in your office.
No, it's all digital. Maybe I'll print them out and send them to you or something.
I just get like a 400-pound box, open it up, and it's just drawings.
Yeah, no, I think it's going to be like a dump truck. Like,
you would need a Kickstarter to fund that shipping.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh man! So speaking of hand-drawn animation, are you looking forward to Cuphead?
Yeah, absolutely. That game is it looks amazing. Cuphead is like early Disney, like 1940s, 1930s, 1940s, 20s, 30s, 40s animation. We were kind of more like the Disney Renaissance animation from like the late 80s, early 90s. But Cuphead, I played it at Gamescom last year, and the bosses are super fun. The game has so much personality, so much style. It's just really, really, really cool.
I just want it to come out already. It's every time you hear about it, it's like, here's new levels and new gameplay. When's it coming out?
Yeah, I don't know. Have they announced a release date yet? Or?
No. I don't think it's ever coming out. They're just going to show demos every year. Until everybody dies. The world ends. And they'll be like, oh, we don't have to release it now.
Yeah. Well, I hope they release it because it's going to be a pretty cool game. I think the boss fights are fun. The levels between the bosses, they look fun too. So the style is just amazing.
So what kind of games do you play in your spare time? What do you, when you're not working on Jotun or the other unannounced games you're not allowed to talk about, what are you working on or what are you playing?
Game I played the most probably in the last 6 months was Hearthstone. So I spent a bit too much time and a bit too much money on that game. I've always been a Magic the Gathering player on and off since I was like, what, like 10 or something, 10 years old.
What era was it when you started playing?
Probably 99, probably.
Is that like
Invasion Block?
Like Mirage era?
Like right after Mirage.
That's like when I stopped playing. I got in like right around Revised, hung out through Ice Age, Alliances.
There's some value in those cards.
Oh, and I don't have any of them anymore.
Ah, man, that's brutal.
Yeah, there. I can only wonder. Like, I've never had like any of the super mega valuable ones, but I can only wonder like what a Jester's Cap would go for nowadays.
No, Jester's Cap, man. That's not a good card, man.
No,
you need to get for like the dual lands or the Moxes or like a Black Lotus or something.
Oh yeah,
like
that. Those are the ones that out of my price range.
Yeah, then you'd be looking at some money. But Jester's Cap, I'm sorry, man, but you're not paying for your Hawaii vacation.
Oh, I know. Well, I like when I played it for a bit and then I stopped and I got back in with Ice Age. And I opened, like, I just bought a starter deck, and the first card I showed was a Jester's Cap, and my friend was pissed. Like, he was buying pack after pack after pack looking for a Jester's Cap, and I just got one in a starter deck, and he was so mad at me.
Did you trade it? You should trade it to him.
I think I did, because, back then, that one was worth $25 back then. Think of all the chocolate milk you could buy.
Shit, yeah, that's a good card, and that's good value for cardboard.
I mean, yeah, it's not the $2,000 Black Lotus, but
yeah, no. So I played a lot of Hearthstone, play a lot of indie games. The last one I played was Salt and Sanctuary, which was really cool. Played a little bit of We Happy Few, which is another studio from Montreal, which is a really really awesome game.
I just talked with the guys from Compulsion, I think 2 weeks ago, something like that.
Nice. Yeah, they're great guys.
Getting a lot of Canadians on the show. It's the Canadian invasion on SML.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're lucky in Canada, man. Game developers in Canada are really, really fortunate because there's a lot of government support in terms of loans and grants and tax credits, stuff like that. So we're really lucky to have this support here.
Yeah, and it's always good to, you know, when I talk with a PR guy and they're like, yeah, we'll set you up with this person. They're in Toronto or they're in Montreal. I'm like, all right, another one. Bring it on.
Yeah, there's a great, great, great scene. Toronto, Montreal, for sure.
And then, what developers up there are you friends with?
We're actually in the same building as Compulsion, Tribute Games, who did Mercenary King, Curses of Chaos, and we're doing Flinthook now, and Double Stallion. Those are all the same. We're all in the same building, but you know,
is it just a commune, a developer commune there?
Yeah, it's like this old vinyl factory that's now like a bunch of office spaces. So
that's pretty.
But
cool.
No, I mean everyone knows everyone here, right? Like, so any smaller size studio, you're gonna run into them at events and stuff. It's a really great community.
What kind of events have you gone to with Jotun?
Like consumer shows, stuff like that.
Yeah, I'm guessing you've hit up all the PAXes.
Yeah, we did. Last year we did PAX East, then South by Southwest, Gamescom, TwitchCon, and then this year we went to GDC, E3, and then PAX West just a week and a half ago.
You guys have any plans on hitting up MAGFest for any upcoming events?
We don't know yet. We're kind of figuring out the strategy, the plan for our next few moves. Yeah. So yeah, kind of nothing to announce there.
MAGFest is the only event I get to every year. So every time someone's on the show, I'm like, "Are you going to MAGFest? Can I see you there?"
Yeah, is it a big show or?
It has gotten huge. The very first MAGFest was like 250 people, and then MAGFest 14 last year was like 15,000.
Wow!
So it is getting massive, and they've been doing an indie game showcase every year.
So, right.
So if you have something to show in January, it is in the DC area, Baltimore Harbor.
Okay.
At the Gaylord National Resort.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, if you have something ready to show for January, maybe you could get in there and show off the game there and meet some new people and party for a weekend.
Yeah. Game these game events, man, there's too much partying going on.
Yeah, the difference with MAGFest is it is not it's not like PAX where it's just a bunch of vendors and, you know, just showing off games and lines, and it is a party. It is a weekend long party. The event doesn't close down. The game rooms are open 24/7, or not 7, but 24/4, I guess.
Wow.
That sounds
like a nightmare to present that. You have to stand there for like 4 days without sleep.
Well, the indie room, they'll have like hours. Like you could be down there overnight if you want, but most people, they'll shut their stuff down.
Yeah,
but
absolutely.
Like the game room itself is open all night, and the merchant area and stuff like that.
Cool. Is that where you're from? Are you from around there then? Or?
I am in Pennsylvania, so I'm about 4 hours away from DC.
Okay, so not too far.
Yeah, so that's basically the only thing I get to every year. I keep telling myself one of these years I'll get to PAX, but...
Yeah, yes. PAX in Boston, PAX East is awesome.
It is so expensive.
Yeah.
It's just...
Yeah, and it sells out in like 30 minutes, right?
Yeah, that doesn't help either. Have to get a program designed to just F5 the page and get tickets right away.
Yeah, exactly. Run a bot.
It's crazy. Absolutely crazy. So what is next for Thunder Lotus Games? Like, how many games are you working on? I know you can't announce anything, but...
Yeah, no, I can't really give you any info on that end. We are working on some new stuff, which we're really excited about. And I think people will be really excited about as well. Right now, we're kind of getting our launching on the consoles was crazy. It was a lot of work. Now we're kind of getting our bearings on that. The future is bright. We're really excited to be able to start talking about some new stuff in the relative near future. Right now we're just happy to see Jotun doing well on Steam, on PS4, on X1, on Wii U, and see people excited about the game. So we're just kind of we're going to keep supporting the game as much as possible on the consoles, you know, do some sales eventually, stuff like that. But it's a crazy adventure that's kind of like the first chapter is kind of closing. So it's a pretty satisfying feeling.
Is it selling well on console? Things doing good?
Yeah, things are doing really good. I mean, we can't be happier. Obviously, I can't like discuss any numbers or anything like that, but we're really happy with the sales.
Good to hear. And critical reception has been good. I know our show enjoyed it, but how's the overall response been so far?
Overall, it's been really good too. I think it's kind of funny, right? Because the Metascore, if you go onto Metacritic, like it's kind of different per platform, even though it's the same game. So I don't know what's going on there, but I think Wii U is our highest Metacritic for some reason. I don't know.
Maybe we gamers are just starved for content, and
maybe
they're not as jaded. They could see a game and be like, "This is amazing! This is amazing! This is amazing!" Where right, someone on PS4 is like, "This doesn't have blood and guts in it." Four out of ten.
Maybe. No, we're really happy with how things have gone on the consoles, and we're excited to be able to finally bring the game to people. A lot of people over the last year have been like, "Hey, when are you coming to PS4? When are you coming to Xbox? When are you coming to all that?" So. We're really, really happy to be able to bring the game to other markets.
Future titles going to be console as well, or are you focusing on PC release first?
Hopefully. We'll see what happens. Obviously, things are unannounced, so I can't really say much. But
I got to poke and prod. I'm trying to get something out of you.
Yeah, no, I'm not going to give you
anything. Is it going to be a video game? Can you confirm it's a video game?
I can confirm that Thunder Lotus Games is a company that makes video games.
Yes, I got you. I knew I would wear you down.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So I'm not sure if there's anything else you want to talk about. I kind of went through everything I could think of.
No, that's it, man. I mean, Jotun's available now on PS4, X1, Wii U, and Steam. GOG, Windows, Mac, Linux, everywhere. Check it out. If you want to impress the gods, it's the game for you.
Where can people keep up to date on what you are doing and what the company is doing?
So the best way to do that is to join our mailing list. Head over to jotungame.com, and just on the bottom part of the screen, there is a mailing list. That is the best way to receive like special things that we're doing, and be the first to receive, you know, like a lot of secret stuff, and a lot of good things happen when you subscribe to the Thunder Lotus mailing list.
I will have to see if I'm on that or not. I've been chatting with Rodrigue, and I'm not sure if I'm on the mailing list or
I think you're definitely on the press list, but the mailing list is more of the fan.
I'm a fan, too. Like, I'm a fan first. I don't like being considered press.
Right. Get on there. Get on there.
Because I'm not professional in any way whatsoever. Just because I've done 200 episodes of this show doesn't mean I know what I'm doing.
Yeah, that's kind of how it feels for pretty much everyone doing anything, I think.
But yeah, for a first effort, god damn, you guys knocked it out of the park with Jotun. It's really enjoyable game, a lot of content, and gorgeous, 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 gorgeous. I can't go on enough about how friggin' beautiful that game is.
Oh, thanks so much, man. Thank you very much for the kind words, and I'm really glad that you enjoyed the game.
And I am thrilled that you came on. If there's nothing else you want to talk about, do you want to give us some final words to end the chat?
Yeah, just Jotun Valhalla Edition is available now on Steam, GOG, Humble, PS4, X1, Wii U. And if you like games about, you know, hand-drawn art, Vikings, and giant epic boss battles, then Jotun's the game for you. Impress the gods.
That sounds amazing.